Learning medicine is hard work. Osmosis makes it easy. It takes your lectures and notes to create a personalized study plan with exclusive videos, practice questions, and flashcards, and so much more. Try it free today.
One essential mineral that our body needs to get through the diet is copper. And typically we take in about 1 to 2 milligrams per day from the food we eat, things like whole grains, beans, nuts, and potatoes. But really, our body only needs about 0.75 milligrams per day, so that extra copper is excreted. About 90% of the excess copper is excreted into the bile, where it eventually ends up as fecal copper, and the other 10% is excreted in the urine. In Wilson disease, there's a genetic defect that results in the excess copper being kept in the body and deposited in various tissues, where it's not supposed to be. And just like iron, free copper reacts with hydrogen peroxide in the body to form the hydroxyl radical, a reactive oxygen species that's pretty good at damaging tissue. So over time, those tissues are seriously damaged by free radical generation. Now, your liver cells, or hepatocytes, play a really important role in helping the body get rid of excess copper. So usually, the copper from the diet is absorbed in the small intestine via enterocytes and passed off into the portal vein to the liver. Once it's in the liver, it's sent to a special transport protein called ATP7B, which has a couple super important jobs. The first job is that it binds copper to apoceruloplasmin, which is the major copper-carrying protein in the blood and is responsible for carrying 95% of the copper in the blood. After it binds copper, it's then just called ceruloplasmin, and this guy can haul 6 molecules of copper at once. ATP7B's other job is to gather up the rest of the copper into vesicles to be exocytosed into the bile canaliculi, where it goes into the bile and is eventually excreted. With Wilson disease, there's an autosomal recessive defect in this ATP7B transport protein. As you could probably guess, that means it can't incorporate the copper into ceruloplasmin or excrete it into the bile. Since it's not doing either of these things anymore, the copper builds up inside the hepatocyte and starts to produce free radicals. Eventually, all this built-up copper and free radical damage injures or destroys the hepatocyte, causing free copper to spill out into the interstitial space and from there into the blood supply, where it's circulated to and deposited in other tissues, where it also causes free radical damage over time. One organ in particular is the brain, and for this reason, Wilson disease can have serious neurological symptoms and complications. Depending on where it deposits, it can cause different disorders. If it deposits in the basal ganglia, it can cause a movement disorder that's a lot like Parkinsonism. If it gets to the cerebral cortex, it can be toxic to neurons and can lead to neuronal cell death and dementia. One place that it can deposit that can be helpful for diagnosis is in Descemet's membrane of the cornea, which is the membrane between the stroma and the endothelial layer of the cornea. So you'll look for something called Kaiser-Fleischer rings, which are visible copper deposits in the cornea. For symptoms, Wilson disease typically causes liver damage first in younger children and preteens, and this often progresses from acute hepatitis to cirrhosis and liver failure. If someone older has the disease, neurological problems will likely manifest first. Typically, when you look at someone's blood with Wilson disease, you'll note a couple pretty key things. One is that there'll be an overall decreased level of ceruloplasmin in the blood, because remember that you need apoceruloplasmin to bind to copper for it to be ceruloplasmin. So without ATP7B binding copper to apoceruloplasmin, all you have is apoceruloplasmin, which is relatively unstable and doesn't last very long in the plasma. This can be important for diagnosing Wilson disease early on. Another key feature to note, as hepatocytes are damaged, they release free or unbound copper, which will lead to increased free copper in the urine. Other common complications from deposited copper in other tissues include an enlarged liver and spleen, hepatosplenomegaly, renal disease due to damage to the proximal tubules of the kidney, and hemolytic anemia due to direct damage that circulating free copper causes to red blood cells. Treatment for Wilson disease involves an initial acute decoppering therapy, followed by maintenance therapy to keep copper levels within the normal range. Treatment options include copper chelators such as trientine, penicillamine, an alpha amino acid metabolite of penicillin without antibiotic properties, and tetrathiomolybdate, and zinc salts. Copper chelating agents bind free copper in the blood and tissues to facilitate excretion. Also though, patients can be given zinc salts, which increases the production of metallothionein proteins in intestinal cells. This protein binds to copper and traps it in the cell, which is shed and excreted in the feces. Finally, if the liver's been damaged to the point of cirrhosis and liver failure, a liver transplant may be needed. Alright, as a quick recap. Wilson disease occurs when there's an autosomal recessive defect in the ATP7B gene, which encodes a protein that's essential for copper transport and excretion. Excess copper is detrimental to the body because it can accumulate in the brain and liver, where they generate free radicals, leading to neurological disorders or liver failure. Treatment involves an initial decoppering therapy with continued maintenance therapy to keep copper levels within the normal range.
Thanks for watching. If you're interested in a deeper dive on this topic, take a look at osmosis.org, where we have flashcards, questions, and other awesome tools to help you learn medicine.